Hello, Chem 30. This is our eighth lesson in the Redox Reactions unit. This is Redox Stoichiometry. In this lesson, we'll look at redox stoichiometry and titrations. We'll move forward with redox titration endpoints. We will look at how to calculate the titrant concentration, and we'll finish with two examples. Consider the following. Redox stoichiometry and titrations are the same as acid-base titrations for the calculations, but have a more detailed chemical equation. To complete redox stoichiometry calculations, you must assume that all reactions are spontaneous, have a mole-to-mole ratio, and are quantitative. In redox titrations, the titrant, the substance in the burette, is usually a strong oxidizing agent or a strong reducing agent. The most common oxidizing agents are acidic solutions of permanganate ions or dichromate ions. The purpose of a titration experiment is to determine the unknown concentration of a solution. This is accomplished by titrating it with a solution with a known concentration, also known as a standard solution. Redox titration endpoints. To mark the endpoint of a reaction, we usually look for a change in the color of the ion in the oxidizing agent. Most oxidizing agents and reducing agents are colored, so a change in color is evidence of the endpoint, meaning it will be self-indicating. Therefore, no external indicator is required for a redox titration. To determine the endpoint, we must consider all ions present in the redox titration. For example, if we consider this half reaction and we use the Chemistry 30 data booklet, we can conclude that the only ions that have a listed color are MnO4- and Mn2+. Moving forward in this lesson, we will explain how to determine the color of a redox titration endpoint in example number 2. Titration calculations. Step number 1. Predict the most likely redox reaction to happen in the solution. This is the knowledge that we learned in lessons R6, which is find your strongest oxidizing agent and your strongest reducing agent. Add the two half reactions together to get your net redox reaction. Step number 2, put the volume and concentration values below each reactant in the balanced redox reaction. Step number 3, use the balanced redox reaction and stoichiometry to calculate the concentration of the unknown solution. Remember, when calculating the average volume added, omit any volume that is not within a 0.20 milliliter range. And always begin your calculation with the substance for which you have both the volume and the concentration. Example number 1. Using the data below, Determine the concentration of potassium permanganate if it is titrated into a 10 milliliter sample of acidic 0.0500 moles per liter tin chloride. Pause this video and attempt this example. If we consider the table provided, it does not tell us what substance is being recorded for volume. But if we look in the question, we can see that there are 10 milliliters of tin chloride. That means it has the set volume. So the table corresponds to potassium permanganate. We have to find the volume added in each trial by taking the final volume minus the initial volume. As shown here, we can see the volume added per trial. Note how trial number one does not fit within the 0.2 milliliter range, so we will disregard trial number one. Before we move forward, we have to consider the significant digits going into this calculation. If we look above, we have 4 significant digits, 3 significant digits, but we also have 2 significant digits in the 0.60 from trial 3. So that means our end answer should have 2 significant digits. Moving forward, we must list all of the species present in the redox titration and label them as oxidizing agents, reducing agents, or both. Remember to look for combinations of species that form oxidizing agents or reducing agents. Using our table of relative strengths of oxidizing and reducing agents, we can conclude that the strongest oxidizing agent will be a combination of MnO4- and H+ ions. Our strongest reducing agent will be Tn2+ ions. We have to write both half reactions from the data booklet. Note how the electrons in both half reactions are not the same. Therefore, we have to multiply the first half reaction by 2 and the second half reaction by 5. This will cancel out the electrons on either side of the equation when we add both half reactions together to get the redox reaction. What is very important about this redox reaction is the molar ratio between 2 permanganate ions and 5 Tn2+ ions. Note below how we have listed the concentration and volume of Tn2+ ions. We can use the table provided in the question to find the average volume of potassium permanganate added. This will be the volume of permanganate ions. We can now start our redox titration calculation. Remember, we always start with the substance for which we have both the volume and the concentration. We will start our calculation with 10 milliliters, which will be converted to liters. We will times it by the concentration of Tn2+ ions to get our answer in the moles of Tn2+ ions. We can then use the molar ratio to find the moles of permanganate ions. Once we have our answer in moles of permanganate ions, we can divide it by the volume in liters of permanganate ions. This results in a concentration of potassium permanganate of 0.012 moles per liter. That will be 2 significant digits from the data table. Example number two. What would be the color of the endpoint when 0.012 moles per liter potassium permanganate is titrated into 10 milliliters of acidic 0.05 moles per liter tin chloride? Pause the video and attempt this example. Below, we can see the same redox reaction from example number one. We have to use the Chemistry 30 data booklet to list the color of all ions present in this reaction. When doing so, we can see that MnO4- will be a purple pink, and Mn2+ will be colorless. The color of the reactants always dictates the endpoint of a redox titration. When the endpoint is reached, one of the reactants is completely consumed. In this instance, that would be tin 2+ ions. Therefore, the next drop added from the substance in the burette will not react and remain in the flask. That would be the next drop of permanganate ions, which would result in a purple endpoint of the redox titration. Moving forward, we will perform a redox titration laboratory.